They sputtered to a 4-2 start without a true center or point guard. But they were about to get one of those. Completing his sit-out period following his transfer from Cleveland State, from his debut against East Carolina in the River City Shootout on, Jimmy Les would spark him. And would time and time again team with Boise on a play that would become his trademark.
We know we're good. You know, it's going to take a lot of hard work and a lot of effort to win the conference, but we know we're capable of doing it, and we're going to go out and do it.
Ahead was maybe the most successful road trip in the history of Bradley basketball. Certainly, they would no longer be a national secret. A three-game trip to Wichita State, Drake, and Dayton. It would showcase the backcourt in the most brilliant and magical way possible. It was on to Des Moines in the Valley TV game of the week against Drake's vastly improved Bulldogs. The first half featured a coast-to-coast steal and kaboom from Greg Jones. And 20 strong points for Mike Williams, many of them clutch free throws. The team fought hard for this one and worked hard at both ends of the floor. Late in the game, Jimmy made a steal and a breakaway layup, and it looked like another Bradley win. But an offensive foul and a missed free throw gave Drake another chance.
Ray Thomas at the free throw line. His first one's up, and that one's too hard. Rebound taken down. Martin with seven, with six, with five. Martin with four, with three. Fires a jumper in for two. And Bradley calls time. Well, it'll be overtime.
I don't know if they're going to honor it. We call time. We should be able with about a second or two to go, I believe, but it don't look like they're going to honor it.
Well, Dick wanted 3 seconds. Gary Garner wanted one or none. The officials decided one. So Dick Versace huddled with his team. What would Bradley do?
Well, got a 1 second play with a length of the floor to go?
Well, yes. And really, that's where you want to throw the ball. It's not going to do us any good to inbound the ball here. You're just as well off throwing the ball at the other end of the floor, gambling on it, getting the ball in the shot, or maybe catching the ball and getting fouled.
Let's get a shot in. How about it not going to overtime? Left. Length of the court pass. It's the Hawkins. He spins. He fires. It's good. Hawkins gets it in, and we win it by two. As Hawkins gets 25, 26, and 27 on a beautiful pass by Les that went over everybody's head right to Hawk, who put it up and in.
Another thing that goes unnoticed, Drake had all five men back. No one was up guarding Jimmy to throw the ball. He had all the time in the world to throw it, but the only thing he could do is throw it down to the free throw line, and he threw it over Mike's head. They defense Mike, and of course Hawk got the ball and put it in, but that's the risk you take when you don't put pressure up.
So you figured nothing could top that, and it was off to Dayton, Ohio. And the team played very well against the Flyers. The backcourt provided 49 points, featuring a skying dunk from the Hawk. But Dayton played well too. Jimmy's Cleveland State teammate Dave Colbert sparked them. With time running down, the score was tied at 67. And Damon Goodman hit a jumper from the left wing with 1 second to go. Would lightning strike again?
Les gets the free pass with 1 second to go. The pass is to Hawkins. He turns and fires from 20.
It counts,
and it's 69-69, and we're going to overtime again.
In the overtime, Bradley had the momentum and made their free throws. They had the hat trick, 16-1, seven in a row, and finally ranked in the UPI, tied with Illinois for 19th. Now, about those last second shots.
Yes, it's basically confidence, and also it's the confidence in which the team has in me and the coaches. You know, the team, they have so much confidence in me that it doesn't allow me to be anything other than confident in myself. And when we came back out, they still didn't put a guy on me, and I just kind of, you know, made like a pitcher and just tried to rifle a baseball pass to Hawk at the top of the key when he popped open. And no one really guarded him at first, and then he went up for the shot. A guy flew at him. He got it over him and put it in. It was a great shot.
And all the wire service poles and all the electronic media poles and the USA Today pole. So that's really, you know, a good sign, I think. And yes, indeed, I think because of what happened, most of the country knows who Hersey Hawkins is.
Second left, 90 feet to go. It's the mountaintop. Versace's got them winning. Nonstop. The Civic Center's filling. The hilltop's all the buzz now.
Every time I came out, you know, I didn't always have a great night or a good shooting night or I, you know, turn the ball over or something. But I was always going to give 110% because I felt that that's what, you know, the people deserve and that's what they came to see. As far as coming out the last time, next Thursday, you know, until recently when I started thinking about it, I didn't know the answer. And it's really going to be strange not to... to think of myself not coming out on the court anymore, though. It's really going to be strange.
I've had no problems with this team whatsoever. They're the most incredibly cooperative group of young men that I've ever worked with. And this profession, when you have the kinds of problems that you read about sometimes, it makes it the toughest and worst job in the world. But when you have a group of lads like I have this year, it makes it the best job in the world. And they've just been an absolute delight, and I love them all very much, and I will never forget them. They put together one of the most incredible years, maybe, when you consider a lot of things, and as we're looked at in the future, in collegiate basketball, for what they were able to accomplish. In 1986, it will always be in the annals of collegiate basketball that the team that had the best regular season record was the Bradley Braves, comprised of these young men. Jimmy, I'll probably never have a player like Jimmy ever again. I think you are blessed, you know, with a player like Jim, maybe only once, you know, in a lifetime. He's the epitome of everything that you would ever want in a person. He's the epitome of everything you'd ever want in the skills that you need. He's the epitome of everything that you would ever dream about in the intangibles. The courage, the leadership, the sacrifice, the unselfishness, all of those things. It's one tremendous package, and it's all sort of encompassed with a real, real finely tuned level of humility. He's a special person. Thank you.
They sputtered to a 4-2 start without a true center or point guard. But they were about to get one of those. Completing his sit-out period following his transfer from Cleveland State, from his debut against East Carolina in the River City Shootout on, Jimmy Les would spark. And would time and time again team with Boise on a play that would become his trademark.
We know we're good. You know, it's going to take a lot of hard work and a lot of effort to win the conference, but we know we're capable of doing it. We're going to go out and do it.
Ahead was maybe the most successful road trip in the history of Bradley basketball. Certainly, they would no longer be a national secret. A three-game trip to Wichita State, Drake, and Dayton. It would showcase the backcourt in the most brilliant and magical way possible. It was on to Des Moines in the Valley TV game of the week against Drake's vastly improved Bulldogs. The first half featured a coast-to-coast steal and kaboom from Greg Jones. And 20 strong points for Mike Williams, many of them clutch free throws. The team fought hard for this one and worked hard at both ends of the floor. Late in the game, Jimmy made a steal and a breakaway layup, and it looked like another Bradley win. But an offensive foul and a missed free throw gave Drake another chance.
Ray Thomas at the free throw line. His first one's up and that one's too hard. Rebound taken down. Martin with 7, with 6, with 5. Martin with 4, with 3. Fires a jumper in for 2. And Bradley calls time. Well, it'll be overtime.
I don't know if they're going to honor it. We call time. We should be able with about a second or two to go, I believe, but it don't look like they're going to honor it.
Well, Dick wanted 3 seconds. Gary Garner wanted 1 or none. The officials decided 1. So Dick Versace huddled with his team. What would Bradley do?
Well, got a 1 second play with the length of the floor to go?
Well, yes. And really, that's where you want to throw the ball. It's not going to do us any good to inbound the ball here. You're just as well off throwing the ball at the other end of the floor, gambling on it, getting the ball in the shot, or maybe catching the ball and getting fouled.
Let's get a shot in. How about it not going to overtime? Left. Length of the court pass. It's the Hawkins. He spins. He fires. It's good! Hawkins gets it in and we win it by 2! As Hawkins gets 25, 26, and 27 on a beautiful pass by Les that went over everybody's head right to Hawk, who put it up and in.
Another thing that goes unnoticed, Drake had all 5 men back. No one was up guarding Jimmy to throw the ball. He had all the time in the world to throw. Did the only thing he could do is throw it down to the free throw line, and he threw it over Mike's head. They defense Mike, and of course Hawk got the ball and put it in, but that's a risk you take when you don't put pressure up.
So you figured nothing could top that, and it was off to Dayton, Ohio. And the team played very well against the Flyers. The backcourt provided 49 points, featuring a skying dunk from the Hawk. But Dayton played well too. Jimmy's Cleveland State teammate Dave Colbert sparked them. With time running down, the score was tied at 67. And Damon Goodman hit a jumper from the left wing with 1 second to go. Would lightning strike again?
Les gets a free pass with 1 second to go. The pass is to Hawkins. He turns and fires from 20.
It counts,
and it's 69-69, and we're going down overtime again.
In the overtime, Bradley had the momentum and made their free throws. They had the hat trick, 16-1, 7 in a row, and finally ranked in the UPI, tied with Illinois for 19th. Now, about those last-second shots.
Yes, it's basically confidence, and also it's the confidence in which the team has in me and the coaches. You know, the team, they have so much confidence in me that it doesn't allow me to be anything other than confident in myself. And when we came back out, they still didn't put a guy on me, and I just kind of, you know, made like a pitcher and just tried to rifle a baseball pass to Hawk at the top of the key when he popped open. And no one really guarded him at first, and then he went up for the shot. A guy flew at him. He got it over him and put it in. It was a great shot.
And all the wire service poles and all the electronic media poles and the USA Today pole. So that's really, you know, a good sign, I think. And yes, indeed, I think because of what happened, most of the country knows who Hersey Hawkins is.
One second left, 90 feet to go. Soon all of the country will know Bradley's back now. The valley they rule, next the mountaintop. Versace's got them winning, nonstop. The Civic Center's filling, the hilltop's all the buzz now. Wise already knew, you just don't mess around with BU. Listen to the sounds of instant excitement.
Left, inbounds pass with 7, Jim with 6, now with 5, now with 4, drives with 3, lay it up with 2, goes in with 1! Now it's left, they're going to run the offense with 4:04 to go. Williams inside, come on! Seconds, just got to make a smart inbound play. And does it the other end of hook. Get ready, Watts. This game is over. Come on. Les gets a free pass with 1 second to go. The pass is to Hawkins. He turns and fires from 20. Go!
Every time I came out, you know, I didn't always have a great night or a good shooting night or I, you know, turn the ball over or something. But I was always going to give 110% because I felt that that's what, you know, the people deserve and that's what they came to see. As far as coming out the last time, next Thursday, you know, until recently when I started thinking about it, I didn't know the answer. And it's really going to be strange not to... to think of myself not coming out on the court anymore, though. It's really going to be strange.
I've had no problems with this team whatsoever. They're the most incredibly cooperative group of young men that I've ever worked with. And this profession, when you have the kinds of problems that you read about sometimes, it makes it the toughest and worst job in the world. But when you have a group of lads like I have this year, it makes it the best job in the world. And they've just been an absolute delight, and I love them all very much, and I will never forget them. They put together one of the most incredible years, maybe, when you consider a lot of things, and as we're looked at in the future, in collegiate basketball, for what they were able to accomplish. In 1986, it will always be in the annals of collegiate basketball that the team that had the best regular season record was the Bradley Braves, comprised of these young men.
Jimmy will probably never have a player like Jimmy ever again. I think you are blessed, you know, with a player like Jim, maybe only once, you know, in a lifetime. He's the epitome of everything that you would ever want in a person. He's the epitome of everything you'd ever want in the skills that you need. He's the epitome of everything that you would ever dream about in the intangibles. The courage, the leadership, the sacrifice, the unselfishness, all of those things. It's one tremendous package, and it's all sort of encompassed with a real, real finely tuned level of humility. He's a special person.